Welcome to biology, the study of living things. Here's a living thing, the duck-billed platypus. It has brown fur, and even though you can't see it, it has a tail like a beaver, it has a bill, and it lays eggs, kind of like a duck. It swims like a duck, but cannot fly. So is this a bird? Is this a mammal? Can it be both? No. In order to decide what kind of living organism this is, scientists have devised a classification system. Nature doesn't make scientists' job very easy. Cute little animals, like the duck-billed platypus, seem to live in the gray areas, the in-betweens. Scientists disagree on the system from time to time, and make changes to hopefully improve that system as new information becomes available. In a very punny way, you could say that the science of classification, called taxonomy, is evolving. Get it? That is what 5.3 and later on 5.4 are all about, classification and organization of living organisms. 5.3 specifically is the classification of biodiversity, and the essential idea here is that species are named and classified using an internationally agreed system. Why are fish classified as fish? Or why are jellyfish classified as cnidarians? But before you turn the lecture off and say, I got this, it's not as straightforward as it seems. So let's dive right in and look at this more in depth. There are some key features and characteristics that you have to know. There are many new terms as well, so buckle up. Who the heck would devote their life to put this system in place, you ask? Carolus Linnaeus would. That is who. This Swedish biologist is credited with devising the currently adopted system for classifying and organizing organisms. In 1735, Linnaeus published his book outlining the first system, called the Binomial System of Nomenclature. Carolus, or let's just call him Carl, would have people send him organisms from all around the world as they came across them. Carl collected organisms, and he decided to organize them. He was super successful. Linnaeus' system was adopted around the world and is a unifying naming convention. Before we discuss the system itself, it's important to note that there are some main reasons to organize living things. You can see those listed here. In summary, it just makes life easier and allows for new organisms to be classified. Humans by nature like structure and organization, and Linnaeus was doing his part. Every 4 years, a group of scientists get together and make any appropriate updates. Let's break down that system and get you acquainted with it. I bet you're already familiar with some parts of it. When organisms are discovered, they're given two names, a common name and a scientific name. In the picture, the pebble crab is the common name. However, depending on translation or location, this might not be called a pebble crab. That makes it confusing. The scientific name for the pebble crab is Xanthias lamarckii. Every organism is given a scientific name. Each scientific name has two parts. The first part is the genus, in this case, Xanthias, and the second part is the species, lamarckii. Another organism with a recognized scientific name is humans, or Homo sapiens. This two-part naming convention is called binomial nomenclature, and uses Latin as their basis. There are some other rules that must be kept in mind for binomial nomenclature. First, the genus is written first and is always capitalized. Second, the species follows and is written in lowercase. Sometimes, you will see a third word following the species that is also lowercase. That is the subspecies. In the case here, Homo sapiens sapiens denotes that this is modern humans. Lastly, it's important to know that when you type a scientific name, that you use italics for the genus and species. If you write it out by hand, the genus and species are underlined. So check it out. Here we have three dog-looking organisms and one baby human. As you all are like, so what? They're three dogs. But that's not the case. Compare for a second their common names and their scientific names. If you only had their common names to go on, you might simply put the two on the right in the same category. Instead, the domestic dog on the left and the Tibetan wolf in the middle are the same species, Canis lupus, and the red wolf is a different species, Canis rufus. This is huge! As a separate species by definition, it can no longer interbreed successfully with either of the animals on the left. The two animals on the left are different subspecies and can interbreed still. As we're talking about evolution in this topic, over time, the two related subspecies may ultimately become two separate species with a common ancestor. Does this make more sense now on why classification is so important? So who are these people that classify things, and what do they do? Well, the specific name of biologists who classify organisms into categories are taxonomists. They classify organisms into groups or ranks, also known as taxa, which is the plural. The taxa that taxonomists use go from large to small. Every taxonomist uses this system regardless of location in the world. At the very largest end, we have life. How do you get into the classification of life? Boom! You are or were a living organism. At the very smallest classification, you have the species. As you know, a species is a group of living organisms consisting of similar individuals capable of exchanging genes or interbreeding. There There are a bunch of taxa in between, and each one, from domain down to species, becomes more exclusive and is based on specific characteristics and features. The ordering of the taxa goes as following: domain, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. It's probably good for you to come up with a mnemonic to remember the order. One example is Katy Perry comes over for grape soda. The picture is likely not Katy Perry, and likely Coke or something. You need to remember it for sure. So you can use this one or suggest coming up with your own. Additionally, some of the specific characteristics of the taxa that you must get to know. So let's move in that direction and learn a little bit more about life. First up below life, we have a taxon known as the domain, and the taxon known as kingdoms. On the domain side, we have three: archaea, eubacteria, and eukarya. Fun fact, when Mr. O first learned this, there were only two. Taxonomists changed it up, and now I had to relearn it. So you can see below the image some of the main features of those three domain. Archaea and eubacteria are microscopic prokaryotic organisms, and they do not have a nucleus. At one point in time, taxonomists grouped these two domains together. But after debating, scientists determined that archaea are found only in extreme conditions, like high methane concentration areas, high salt concentration areas, and hot temperature areas. P.S. The suffix phyle means loving, and the prefix is methane is for methane, halo is for salt, and thermo is for temperature, so you put it together. Eubacteria, on the other hand, live in everyday human conditions and tend to be things like pathogens. Eukarya are known for their eukaryotic cells, which have a nucleus and membrane-bound organelles. Due to this, eukaryotes tend to be larger. I am a eukaryote, and so are you. Just below this taxon, we have the taxon called kingdom. There are six kingdoms in total. Archaea is also a kingdom, and so is eubacteria. In eukarya, we have four kingdoms: protista, fungi, plantae, and animalia. You might also hear the word eukaryotes for this kingdom. Underneath all of the kingdoms, there are phyla, classes, orders, family, genera, and species. However, we only want to focus on some of the specific plant and animal phyla. We will come back in a bit and learn more about those special phyla within the kingdoms of plantae and animalia. Before getting there, it's important to break down the three different types of classification. Historically, there have been two types of classification, natural and artificial. Natural classification involves grouping organisms based on similarities and identifying shared characteristics. According to a natural classification system, all members of a particular group would have shared a common ancestor. This means that natural classification schemes can be used to predict characteristics shared by species within a group. These are some pretty hefty advantages. One disadvantage of such schemes is that they are highly mutable and tend to change as new information is discovered. But that is science, and that is okay. Science is flexible like that. With artificial classification, this involves arbitrarily selecting unifying characteristics first and then grouping organisms accordingly. The advantage is that such schemes are easy to develop and relatively stable, and they're unlikely to change. The disadvantage is they do not generally show evolutionary relationships, and for this reason, they're not commonly used. And by not commonly, I really mean not at all. For example, if organisms were classified according to the presence of fins, then whales would be grouped with fish. If organisms were classified based on presence of shells, then snails would be grouped with turtles and not with squid. We know that snails are not like turtles, so artificial classification is not the best route and would likely end up naming the duckbill platypus as a bird. One emerging classification system is phylogenetic, which as it sounds is used by determining relationships based on similar DNA or amino acid sequences. This can be super helpful when used with natural classification. Taxonomy and yoga have at least one thing in common. Do you know what that is? They are flexible. Some practitioners are more flexible than others, but it is important to change when the facts present themselves. This can be frustrating as well as really cool. Groups of species may be separated into different genera if new evidence suggests they evolved from different ancestral species. Alternatively, different species may be grouped into a shared taxon if new evidence suggests more recent common ancestry. Take the example I give you below. In the old classification system, the hominidae family contained just one genus of organisms, Homo. However, after new evidence was discovered, scientists reclassified the family and realized that, hey, these things are not as far apart as we once thought, and shifted many of the other primates into the same family, except the gibbons. So that's my example. Let's move on to the skills and applications portion of this content. First, one application you must know how to do is classify one plant and one animal from kingdom to species, and of course know its common name as well. Here I've provided you with two examples, humans and the buttercup. I recommend that you pick your favorite plant and favorite animal and do the same. It will help you remember when the assessment time comes. You should pause it here and go do this. Another application of this is knowing the distinguishing characteristics of four plant phyla. In total, there are 12 phyla within the plantae. You can see here just the four you need to know. They can be differentiated according to some key features, so gaze your eyes on the chart as I read. First, we have the bryophyta, or bryophytes. These have no vascularization, which means it lacks a part called the xylem and phloem, and they have no true leaves, roots, or stems, and reproduce by releasing spores from sporangia. Some examples include mosses and liverworts, and you can see the sphagnum moss in the picture below. They tend to be small as well. Second, we have the phyllicinophyta, or phyllicinophytes. In contrast to bryophytes, these have vascularization and have roots, stems, and leaves. The leaves are pinnate, which means they look like feathers, having leaflets on either side of an axis down the middle. Just like bryophytes, they reproduce by releasing spores on the undersides of their leaves. Some examples include ferns. Third, we have the coniferophyta, or coniferophytes. These too have vascularization and have roots, leaves. They have woody stems as well. In contrast to bryophytes and phyllicinophytes, coniferophytes have seeds and store them in cones. Some examples are conifers, like pine trees, and cedars. Lastly, we have angiospermophyta, or angiospermophytes. These have vascularization, roots, leaves, and woody stems. Different from all the others, these are characterized by their ability to have flowers and also to have fruits, which contain seeds. These include all flowering plants and grasses, so think fruit trees and grass. You must be able to compare and contrast these four phyla, as well as identify them based on look and characteristic. Additionally, I will point out that in evolution, you can see that the oldest are the bryophytes and the newest are the angiospermophytes. We know this because features such as woody stems, seeds, and vascularization were all distinguishing characteristics of more complex plants. Just like plant phyla, you need to know phyla of the animal kingdom. There are 7 animal phyla you must know. 6 of these are invertebrates, meaning they do not have a vertebral column. The last one is a class within the phylum Chordata, and those are the vertebrates, and they're distinguished by having a vertebral column. We will discuss those in the next slide. The 6 invertebrate phyla of kingdom Animalia are as follows: Porifera, Cnidaria, Platyhelminthia, Annelida, Mollusca, and Anthropoda. You can see in the table their features that you should be able to know about them, as well as an example of each in the picture below. I will not talk about them specifically, but you need to be able to outline the characteristic of the 7 major animal phyla and identify the phyla of animal given, so I would pause it now as you need, so you can write some of that information down. The final application of this is knowing the distinguishing features of the class Vertebrata. Better known as vertebrates, this is a class within the phylum Chordata. Chordates are distinguished by a notochord, which we will learn about later on this year. Vertebrates are characterized by having a vertebral column. All vertebrates are chordates, but not all chordates are vertebrates. That's how the relationship goes. However, just like in the previous slides, we need to learn about some key features. You should be able to outline the characteristics of 5 major vertebrate classes and identify the vertebrate class of animal, given some external features. Specifically, the features to distinguish are body covering, reproduction, breathing, temperature regulation, and some other features. So pause the video here and make sure you got these down. Lastly, there's one skill that you need to be able to do, which is construct a dichotomous key. A dichotomous key is a method of identification whereby groups of organisms are divided into 2 categories repeatedly. With each sequential division, more information is revealed about the specific features of a particular organism. When the organism no longer shares its totality of selected characteristics with any organism, it's been identified. When using a dichotomous key to help identify specimens, it's important and preferable to use immutable features. And these are features that don't change. Things like size, coloration, and behavioral patterns may all vary among individuals and across lifetimes. Physical structures, something like number of limbs, and biological processes like reproduction methods make for better characteristics. Dichotomous keys are usually represented in one of two ways: as a branching flowchart, some sort of diagram representation, or as a series of paired statements laid out in a number sequence, which is a descriptive representation. You can see both of these examples here. If we look at the example on the bottom, we can see that the vertebrate classes are in a branching flowchart with specific distinguishing characteristics narrowing the classes down. For instance, you have the distinguishing characteristics of body covering, so have fur, no fur. In the second example, a series of paired yes or no statements or questions can assist by helping to narrow down until you come to a specific end. For instance, the question, does it have hair or fur, is a good question as it works to narrow down the group. Is either way more correct? Nope. What is important is that you choose the method that works for you so you can construct your own dichotomous key. We will be practicing creating these as well as working through them in class. So keep it real, and the next time you're faced with a plant or animal, try to classify it. Do it. As always, it's really important to give credit where it's due. While the presentation, script, and video are solely of my own creation, many of the images and information contained in the presentation are not. So shoutouts to the following. Most of the images and video clips come from IB BioNinja and some of the information used. Other images and info come from Bionology, iBiology, and Biology for Life. Lastly, some information was gleaned from the Cambridge edition of the IB Biology Tech, as the intended purpose of this presentation is to provide you with yet another resource tool to enhance your learning for the IB Biology curriculum. So peace out.